I want to talk a little bit about my two siblings, Spud and, well, Tommy, Thomas we called Tommy. We actually called him Tink. You know, he was 10 years younger than me and 11 years younger than Spuddy. But Spud was the personification of Granddaddy and Uncle Brad. He was sweet to the kind to the bone. Everybody loved him. He was the president of the school board. You know, he was just, people came to him for advice. He was a wonderful, wonderful man and a great father and husband. He excelled in school. He was always class favorite. You know, if you'd vote him in, you know, he always won all of that because people loved him. And he was, after he died, a girl that we'd been in school with, that I barely remembered, I hadn't seen her in 40 or 50 years, you know, she wrote me a note and she said that Spud was her idea of what a gentleman would be. And that no matter where he was, he looked you in the eye and spoke to you. And he always made me feel better. Everybody was the same to him. And I thought it was one of the greatest tributes I've ever heard to anyone say in my life. He had some lifelong friends. Our cousin Charles Wayne Eason, we called him Charlie, was very close to him. Damon Weems was another one. Oh, excuse me, those are Tommy's friends. I've got them mixed up. Let's forget, I'll tell you, those were the Tommy's two good friends. Being 10 years older than Tommy, when they brought him home to the hospital, I remember it very vividly. They brought Mother in an ambulance. The ambulance backed up to the door, and they pulled her out, and then, on one of those sliding cot things. And they brought this round basket. And my baby brother was in the round basket. And I had some friends that didn't have younger brothers and sisters, so Spud and I charged them to dime to come in and look at him. I guess making money. I'll tell you another thing we do, and I look back on this in shame, because we honestly didn't know. If Mother and Daddy took us out to dinner, we let them kind of get away from the table as we were leaving. Daddy always left a big tip on the table, and we took the tip. We thought, you know, that was up for us to grab. We didn't realize what a tip was or what it was for. And I felt so bad about that. And then he and I split it, you know. One year for Christmas, we got a really fancy record player. And it was in a really beautiful case. I remember it was striped red and green and yellow. It was so pretty. Of course, it played 45s back at that time. And we opened it on Christmas, and we were delighted. And we had a lot of other stuff. Of course, we always had huge Christmases. But then the next morning, Daddy said, y'all get ready. We're going to Mississippi. Now, Mother rarely went to Mississippi with us. She didn't like it down there because they didn't have hot water. They didn't have central heat. And they didn't have an indoor toilet. So, you know, she didn't go very often. But anyway, so we pack up and get in the car and we leave. And when we came back, we had left the record player on and burned up. We were both just sick about it. You know, we just were so upset about it. And but, you know, that's what kid things go through. And, you know, Spud and I, we would have the measles at the same time. We'd have the mumps at the same time. Because we were so close and we sat in, as I said, we sat in the same seat at school. He took art and he was, I think, very talented. He just didn't do it very long. We both took speech. And now this is something really interesting, I think, that you would want to know. If Spud was going to be in a speech recital, or I was going to be on a speech recital, or I was going to be in a piano recital, Daddy went to the teacher and he said, now look, here's the way I like this. They need to perform first. And so I always knew that if we had a speech recital, I had to lead off. Or if Spud had one, he had to lead off. Or if I had a piano recital, I had to lead off. Because when we performed it, he got up and left. That's what that was all about. he would just get up. He'd already seen his kids and he could go. So Daddy would just get up and leave. So that's why it was a dreadful thing, because we always knew we were going to have to be first. And he'd just get up and leave.
But nobody could do that anymore. Nobody could go to a teacher and just go, my kid's going to be first.
Well, but if you lived in El Pato at that time and you were Doc Richardson, you could. So it was just one of those things. That's the way it worked, you know.
Could you tell us a little bit about, if you remember anything, about Dad being sickly and having to drink goat milk?
Oh, yeah.
Y'all had a cart, a goat and a cart?
A goat cart, we did. That was true. when he was little, he had mastoids in his ear, and I don't even know what a mastoid is, but anyway, it was, I know his eardrums burst, you know, and he was just real sick, and he was allergic to milk, and so we had a goat and a goat cart that, at that time, of course, Daddy still had the dairy, and Daddy built a house sort of back away from us, and the Cheneys lived there, and Mr. Cheney ran the dairy for Daddy, you know, and I remember Mr. Cheney would bring in the paper and the goat milk every morning for Spud, you know, to have. But I was always a lot bigger and taller and stronger than Spud. I know when I was 12 years old, I was 5'7" and a half. And of course, the boys were all probably 5 feet, you know. But fortunately, my three best friends were as tall as I was.
Yeah, they were.
So, and of course, the boys eventually caught up with us. Spud was very popular in school, very, very popular, because everybody liked him so much. He was a great, he was a good athlete. He played, you know, first string on the basketball and football. And we always had dances after the football game. And a lot of times we would have them at our house. We had a big rec room. And then we had another big terrace that Daddy had enclosed. And we would skate there. He didn't put it on. The only thing out there was a deep freeze. He left it for us to skate in, because skating was a big thing then, to go to skating rinks. That was, I remember I got white leather lace-up skates one year for Christmas, and that was just, my heart was full, because I loved those, but that was a fun thing to do. And then if we wanted to go to a movie, we'd go to Mark Tree, because we had two theaters in Lepanto, and then slowly they closed, and then they had a nice big theater in Mark Tree. It was only 10 miles away, and we, you know, all the kids drove over there. And I've talked already about how East Arkansas is just one big fraternity anyway, so.
Yeah.
I remember when Spud went to the university, they made me go my first year down to MSCW in Columbus, Mississippi, because five or six of my granddaddy Vance's sisters had gone to school there. And it was a girls' school, and you had to wear a uniform. I did not like it. Did not like it at all, but but they did a big article down there on me, because I had so many great aunts that had gone to school there, and the school made a concession actually to get me there. You were not allowed to have a car, and I had a new Ford convertible, and I didn't want to lose my car, so the school agreed that I could drive my car down there. I couldn't go home for the first 30 days. But then after that, with a written letter of permission from my mother, I could go home for the weekend. Of course, it was a long drive. I really didn't go very much. Then the airlines were started running little bitty airlines. And I remember my first flight was from Columbus to Memphis. And Ellen Bradford was the queen of that airline. Later on, when they had those little elections about the favorite stewardess or whatever, you know. But, of course, I didn't know her at that time. But for $10, which was a lot of money then, I could fly around trip. And rather than me drive, that's, you know, usually what I did. But anyway, and I didn't go. You know, after, once you get settled in at school, you don't go home that much. You know, we were. But Spud was not happy at school. He missed his friends. And I remember when he came home at Christmas, he told Daddy he was quitting school. He wasn't going back. And Daddy said, well, I can't make you go to school, but by God, you're going to go up there and live. And he made him go back and live in Fayetteville the school year. And of course, he did go back to school, but he didn't do too well. He just wasn't his cup of tea, you know. But I thought that was pretty smart. Daddy said, well, I can't make you go to class, but I'll tell you one thing, you're going to live up there. Thinking that would make him, you know, but it didn't. So the next year, of course, he got out. Anyway, it was one of those things. So you never know, you know, how things will turn out, but he was smart and innovative and kind, so he made it fine, you know. Great guy.